like I said, next up we're going to be playing Cartographers. This is the base Cartographers, not Heroes, but I say that because I received a mat from Thunderworks Games, which is the Heroes mat. So, just to alleviate all confusion, we will be playing the regular Cartographers, but showing off the nice mat from Thunderworks Games. So hopefully y'all can play along. I'll be setting up and then we'll get started in just a few minutes. Get off all these pieces. And if you don't know how to play, feel free to ask questions. I know a lot of y'all know how to play, but I'll probably quickly hit on the rules. But if you don't understand something and want more clarification, I'm more than happy to clarify. But I will be using this over here. I'll show you stuff up close if you need to. Dutch is working and lurking. Well, thank you for stopping by regardless. If you would like to, I do have a fun little lurk command. You're more than happy to use it if you choose to. Of course, no obligation. But I appreciate everyone who shows up, lurking or not. So, had a little fun setting up that command because it's so much fun, whether you're listening or not. We want to talk about how awesome everyone is here. So, these A through D cards we'll not be using because it's already on the mat, so I'll set these aside. Let me pull out the scoring cards. We'll go through those randomly. Now, in the space game, there are four monsters. We'll shuffle those and randomly put one into the deck each season. I'm going to put those up here, easy to draw from. I believe last time I played on the A side of the map. I'm going to switch it up, go to the B side of the map. So if you're playing along, if you have your own copy, pull out the B side of your maps. Pull out all these scoring cards. Thank you, Duchess, and welcome. Welcome. I'm glad you're here. I appreciate you stopping by, whether you're here for just a moment or extended. Thank you. It means a lot for everyone joining me and showing me the love. It's not without all of y'all that I even got here. So thank you very much. And we're getting ready to play our first game of Cartographers, if you would like to play along. I'm going to be lurking, still at work. Of course, I understand. We have a couple of the lurkers. We do have a lurk command if you choose to use it. Of course, no obligation. Getting these scoring options shuffled, so we will be doing this completely randomly. Yeah, ooh, but Cartographers, maybe you can multitask. Yeah. Now, if you don't feel you can multitask, I will be posting all of this to YouTube later on if you feel you want to go back and watch and play along. I'll try to announce each card I draw, so if you can't be looking at the screen the whole time, you can still attempt to play if you want to. Let's go one from that deck, one from that deck, one from there, and one from those. So now we have the four different scoring types of cards. And we'll shuffle them. And Chelsea's going to lurk. Thank you for lurking, Chelsea. Thank you for being here. Appreciate it. Indeed, you are awesome. I know life is busy, but it means a lot that you've stopped by. Let's go A, B, C, and D is going to be these, so let's see what we got going on. For A, we're going to be using the Greenbow. Earn one reputation star for each row and column with at least one forest space. And the same forest space may be scored in a row and a column. A high scoring one indeed. Typically, I like seeing that in the C and D spaces, so you have a lot more time, but you get to rescore it at the end for A. So we still get a decent amount of points off of it. For B scoring, we're going to be using the Green Gold Plains, which will earn three reputation stars for each cluster of village spaces that's adjacent to three or more different terrain types. Duchess is going to lurk as well. Well, thank you. Whether you play along or not, I hope you have a wonderful day at work and evening. And Chelsea says, of course. I may have missed when exactly that was referenced to, either us talking about her or about the cards flipped up. But regardless, we'll figure it out. Next up in C, we have the Borderlands, where we can earn 6 reputation stars for each complete row or complete column of filled spaces. Definitely a solid one to see in the C and D space. Last but not least, in the D space, we have our Canal Lake. So we'll earn 1 reputation star for each water adjacent to at least one farm, and earn 1 reputation star for each farm space adjacent to at least one water. If you want close-ups of those, just let me know. I'll put them over here on the close-up cam, and we can switch the views real quick. Where did I put... There. Almost started mixing those in. Actually, I did mix them in. There they are. The season cards. Make sure they're in the right order. We'll put the seasons right here. And as many of you know, during the first season, we'll end up scoring the A and B scoring cards. So, if you want to focus on getting the green into those rows and columns, and getting your red next to 3 different types of terrain, that will help a lot. So let's make sure we grab one of those monsters to shuffle into the explore deck. No, actually, I like to put it in here in the middle so we don't have to read where it says skills, because like I said, we're using the mat for the Hero Cartographer Heroes, which is coming out very soon, which has skills that they've added to the game. But we're playing with the base Cartographers game. And we'll be playing on the B side of the map. Now for those viewing and watching, whether you're playing along or not, if y'all want to give me a title for my cartographer name, because typically you put your name and a title at the top right here, I want y'all to choose my title. I know when I played with Just the Stream, picked a pretty great title for me. I was the Pathfinder to the Broken Road. Or Broken Roll. I'd have to reread my writing. But it's a fun little name. If y'all want to come up with a unique title that I use, or we can wait till the end and see how well we score. Yes, thank you very much for the follow, Great Harlequin. I appreciate it very much. It means a lot that you've stopped by, given me that follow. Shows me how much you appreciate me being here as much as I appreciate you. So it spreads a little joy into my life as I play games, and hopefully spreading joy back to the community. So I hope everyone is ready. If you're playing along, I believe I'm ready to start this out. I'll put this here so anyone... can I do it without it blocking the mat? But it's upside down. There. Y'all can have fun with that. Or maybe this will be better. That's better. Because we want to show everyone what we're playing. And while we're not using that camera, something can be on it. So as you know, we'll be revealing one of the explore cards at a time. We'll be drawing it onto our map based on the shape and color on the explore card. You can put it anywhere on your map. The middle of this map is already filled in. Empty spaces. There's some mountains that are already on there. If you completely surround the 4 sides of the mountain, you can earn a coin, which allows you to score that coin at the end of the 4 seasons if you've had that coin ready. And we have this 4 random scoring options. Typically, you always have one green, red, basically line or empty that's not color-based, and then blue or yellow. And Great Harlequin says, glad to support any fellow board game. I appreciate it very much. And Jess is asking about Sir Parrot. You're so ready to see that onesie. Well, the onesie is up above my shoulder, as you can see. I'd have to double check what I set that the channel point allowance at for that, because I wanted to give it a little bit of time for you to all, you'll have to earn it. Looks like I said at 3,000, so it may take a stream or two before y'all fully have enough to make me wear it. But it is hanging up there ready for me to have to wear for a full stream as soon as y'all earn enough points and hit it. So I hope everyone's ready to start. I'm going to actually move the seasons up a little bit so I can put this more right here central, a little bit easier to see. But like I said, this first season, at the end of it, we will be scoring the A and B, which is the Greenboro and Green Gold Plains. And we're looking for a total of 8 or more on our Explore cards. So let's get this game started. If you're not ready or need me to slow down, feel free to say so at any time. But our first card will be the Hinterland Stream. So as you can see, it is either the yellow farms or the blue waters and the larger V L shape, however you want to call it. But it is a total of 5 little squares on that. See if this one focuses better. That might be better. 15% to that onesie goal. See, I've debated making it where it's a group goal too, but I haven't set up any group goals yet. Since I'm still learning all the setup. But yeah, y'all could all earn enough points and then like stream after stream after stream, redeem will make me wear it almost every time too. Maybe what I'll do after tonight, I'll get a picture of myself in the onesie and have it posted so you can see what it looks like and then decide when you want to make me wear it for the whole time. Or maybe I'll make it a really big community group goal to make me wear that onesie at a convention or something. So I need to draw in my Hinterland string. These are all good options. I want green everywhere, blue and gold, blue and yellow to end up touching. Let's see, what were the shapes for that? I'm gonna go with the blue. Get me some water going. And I might as well, since I know I want to fill in for C later, full rows or columns, I'm going to start working on doing that by starting to surround this mountain. It is not fully surrounded yet, so I will not get the coin just yet. But this mountain on this edge does get me 2/3 of the way to a full surround of that mountain. And filling in 2 columns, or closer to filling in 2 columns than on if you're playing the A side. Okay, so I'll leave that right there. We'll go to the next Explore card, but we'll leave that one visible if you're a step behind. I'll try not to rush it. Next up we have the Hamlet, which is going to be the red village spaces. You have the choice of the small V and earn a coin immediately, or the bigger, I don't even know what to call that shape, it's basically the square with the one sticking off of it. But yes, it does have to be a red village. Now remember, with the villages, you want it to be touching 3 different terrain types to score. And the mountains do count as a terrain type, but these empty spaces in the middle of the map do not count as a terrain type, if you're playing along. Keep that in mind. But like I talked about, I like to get mountains surrounded as quickly as possible. And this chance to earn 2 coins at once is hard to pass up. So filling in right here, I'm going to use my pen to fill in my coins. So that's 1 coin for the mountain surround. I'm going to put an X in it to show that I got that coin. And because I chose the smaller V, I do get a coin for that as well. Yeah, let me know everyone's stream schedule. Hopefully I get a chance to jump into your chat as well. When I'm free, of course. It's most of you all know I also stream with Chris the Charity Board Gamer on multiple nights, and I have the in-person gaming with Chelsea on Wednesday nights, so I try to jump in and chat when I'm able. It happens more on the weekends than not, but I try to share the love back, really show my appreciation for everyone who drops by and try to go drop into theirs. Of course, I drop into other people's as well, even if they're not here, but it's great to help each other as we can. So, we're a total of 3 so far for the season. As you can see, the tops of these Explore cards have numbers. We're looking for a total of 8 or more for spring. So, we keep going. Next up, we have the Treetop Village. It's one of those elongated Z shapes. This can be either your Fort Green Forest or your Red Villages. Now, this is great that green has showed up because we're going to be scoring this for A. So we want to get these as early as possible, use them while we can. Remember, for every row and column that has at least one forest, you score a point. And Great Hurricane, yes, tomorrow evening, 9 p.m. BST plus one, and maybe Thursday during the day in the usual Sunday board games. It's great to know. So hopefully I can catch one of those. I feel I'm already following you, but no, before I forget, I'm going to go make sure I am following you. Yes, I'm already following. Great. So I should get those notifications when you go live. Okay, back to our Treetop Village. I need to draw that in. And like I was saying, you get a point for every row and every column that has a force in it when we score it. Of course, we're all doing this together to grow together, and the best way to grow is to be able to promote our times. And I know it's not spam because we're here supporting each other, and it's not you just dropping in and throwing the schedule and not saying anything. Like, you're actually hanging out, and that's appreciated. And the best way I can show my appreciation is find ways to support you back. And right now, the easiest way is to talk about our schedules when we're all streaming, what we're all playing, how we can all support each other. So let's see, we're going to keep going with get this in, like I talked about. Now, since we talked about another type touching the red, I might as well touch the red while as I do this. So I'm going to shift this in right here. Hopefully work on that column. We're filling it all in by the end for scoring during the C steps. Well, thank you very much. I appreciate that. It's been a fun ride getting here, and hopefully even a lot more fun as I continue to play even more games, spreading the joy as I can, regardless of how big I grow. And we're a total of 5 currently, so we're going to move on to the next card, and it will be the Great River, where you have 2 choices. Both would have to be blue water, either a 1x3 with a coin, or you can do the W shape. Remember, we are trying to set ourselves up to have farmland next to this water, so if you clump all your water together, you won't be able to score it next to farm. So be mindful of how you set this up for yourself. I think I'm going to work on continuing above this empty stuff to be ready for the full columns. So I think setting up I'm gonna go straight up the middle with this one. I was debating next to the mountain, but straight up the middle means I can at least finish one down here. A lot easier. So that, and because I chose the smaller three, I can then earn a coin for that. Already putting me at 3 coins, which will be nice since I can score those coins every season. And we're currently sitting at a total of 6 for the season, looking for 8 or more. So we keep moving. Oh, our first monster. So we'll go over how this works. This one is the Kobold Onslaught. Because we're playing the solo rules for monsters, and we can't really pass our maps for a standard multiplayer game, we're going to be doing what the solo does, even though the in-game scoring will be based on a multiplayer game, because it's more fun that way. So, this kobold tries to start in the bottom left corner of your map using this shape. The shape cannot be rotated or flipped. It will have to go in that orientation. If it cannot fit in that bottom left corner, it will start to go around the map shown on this direction indicator right here on the left. This one goes clockwise, so it travels up and around the map clockwise direction until it can finally fit in, slowly moving in towards the center of the map. If it gets around the whole thing once, steps in a square, continues on. Now, as you can see, my map is pretty open in that corner, so I have no choice but to push it into that bottom corner. Now, keep in mind, any of these that still have empty spaces adjacent to them at the end of a season will score you negative points per empty space next to it. So now this does change my general plan, as I'll need to start working around this a little bit more to not get as many negative points. The nice thing is these do not count as part of the season numbers, so we're still at a total of 6. Now, this was the one monster in the deck so far, where we will be mixing in more monsters in later season, but this one cannot come out again, which is the nice thing. It can only happen to us once. So once you draw that in, we'll move on to the next shape. And we have the Forgotten Forest. This, of course, is the Green Forest. You have 2 options here. You either have 2 singles that are diagonal to each other and earn a coin at the exact same time, or you have the Z shape, but no coin. So depending on how you want to play this into your map and hopefully either block off part of the monster or, of course, earn some points for your green burrow, this is up to you how you figure that out. So unfortunately, this is a catch-22 for me, because I would like to use it to block off some of the monster spaces, but then I end up losing out on scoring some of its value because I already have this green over here. So I'm going to play a bit risky. That's what, 2, 4, but that's 1, 2. Nope, I'm not going to play risky. I'm going to block the monster. And go for the slightly safer move. And I'll explain, by doing so, it nets me more points. Because if I block it off here, that's negative 1 point for each of those empty spaces I can block per season times 4. So that's 8 points I can stop from losing, plus 2 in this column. So that's 4. So that's more of a 12-point play, as opposed to up here, it'd be what, 1, 2, 3, 4, only 8 points, and still losing all those points. So the switch in how many points you can earn by starting to block off monsters is pretty huge in these early rounds. So that's what I want to do. I'm just going to use the 2 diagonal ones, actually. Go right here and here, and go and get that coin as well. And by getting that coin, that's additional extra points I can earn every round. Now, you do have a maximum number of coins down here. I don't remember what they call this column, but it basically just tracks how many coins you have earned already. So if you reach the top of that, you can't earn it anymore. So just be mindful of that as you pick different shapes. Total of 7, we still need to take another explore card. And this will be the last. It's the Fishing Village. Now this is a 1x4, either red village or blue water Now remember, we will be scoring the red of villages that touch at least three different terrain types. So if you have an opportunity to have it touch multiple terrain types right now, here's your chance, because we're about to be scoring that for its first time. If you choose the red village. And remember, mountains do count as a terrain type, but the empty spaces do not. Now, it does not look like I have a space where I can actually touch three different terrain types at once, so I'm just going to build into blocking monsters and building into my borderland scoring for the following seasons. So I'm going to do that 1x4 right down here under this mountain. Blocks the monster, so I'm going to get no negative points from that monster at all for the rest of the game, which will be really nice. And it starts surrounding my mountain as well. Now, since we hit 8 or more for the season, we'll now score the season, which is A and B, these two. So we'll start with the first one. I'll walk you through the scoring. Hopefully you can score your own as well, and then you can let me know how you did if you're playing along. So this green bow, we get one reputation point for each row and column that has at least one green forest. And one green forest can count for both a row and column at the same time. So I'm going to just go with my columns first, see how many I have, then go with my rows, and we'll add them together. I have 1, 2, 3, 4 columns. Pretty simple. And now my rows, I have 1, 2, 3, 4. So, 8 total points. And you put that right down here. There's a space for the first and second scoring card that you do. Then you'll have a place for coins and any negative for monsters, which I'll hit in a moment. Next up, we have the B. You have the green gold plains. 3 points for each village that's touching at least three different terrain types, or mountains, and even monsters count as a terrain type. So in this case, this village is only touching two types, but this one is touching three with the forest, water, and mountain next to it. So I've scored one of those. So not a huge amount of points, just 3. But it's points nonetheless. Next up, we have coins. Count how many coins you've already earned in this row. Currently I have 4, so that's going to be 4 points for the round on coins. And then any adjacent spaces next to a monster that are empty. Don't worry about diagonals, just the adjacent. If they're empty, have nothing there, they would score you negative. In my case, I've blocked them all, so it's 0 negative points. And so for the round, I've earned, 8 plus 3 plus 4 is going to be 15 points. Not a huge amount, but also not too terrible. A lot of the cards we had come out were not as conducive to a huge score for this first round. But that's part of the point. You kind of build it up semi-planning for the future rounds, as those are your big scoring rounds typically. So now we're going to take all these explore cards, take them back to the deck. We're going to add one monster card without looking at it, so we don't know which one it is. We're going to be shuffling. We'll also be moving on to the next season. So we'll be scoring the B and C cards next. So we'll be scoring the green gold plains with villages touching at least three different terrain types. But this time we'll also get to score any complete row or column that is fully filled in will earn you 6 points. So that's one of the fun things about playing this B side of the map, is if you get this scoring option and you play into it, you can score several vertical ones pretty easily if you've planned correctly. So that's what I try to do, as I try to work vertically on this map. So as you can see, I've already started that. Hopefully I can fill in this bottom section and then continue the rest of those up. And then that may also play into playing across this bottom right as well for some rows filled in. If you're playing along with me, let me know. Let me know how you scored that round. Whether it was amazing or what you might feel is not so amazing. You still have plenty of chances to score again, catch up, and beat me. So don't worry about what it is. Feel free to share if you want to. If you're not playing along, thanks for chatting along. Okay, so we got a little shuffle into that. like I said, this monster that's already been revealed does not go back in. It just stays there to kind of remind you, hey, negative points. Watch for your purple monsters on the board. So we've done that, and we're prepared to move on to the next round. Pretty easy to reset for the, between rounds. Doesn't take a lot of effort, especially if you played this a lot. You get used to it really fast. So our first card for the season is going to be our Orchard. This we have our Green Forest or our Yellow Farmlands in this kind of short L shape. Now this is exactly what I hoped for. Hopefully you got just as lucky too with how you set up your map. Oh, well done. Well done, Duchess. 17 points. So I got really lucky with this Orchard coming out. It's what I was looking for because I was planning ahead and hoping it came out. So I'm going to fill in this space down here, that little L shape, with this farmland. So I have a little bit of farmland touching my water. That'll help me score during the D phase. It's going to help at least complete at least one of my columns. Hopefully I can complete another one. It gets me a third terrain type touching my village as well. So I can score another one of those as it scores again this round. And it works on my mountain space as well. So there's kind of almost a perfect draw for the beginning of this round. So I can now plan somewhere else on the map. Okay, next card we got coming out is an Outpost Ruins. When you draw an Outpost Ruins, it means the next card drawn has to be played on one of the Outpost spaces, if any of them are available. So at least one of the squares of the shape drawn will have to go onto that Outpost. If you have no Outpost remaining somehow, which often happens near the later rounds, then you are allowed to draw a 1x1 square of any terrain type anywhere on the map, but only if all of your outposts have already been covered. Sorry, the ruins. I believe the other ruins may not say outposts, may say something else, but I believe most of y'all followed along without issue. So the card that we have to put onto the Outpost Ruins is going to be our Marshlands. It is our tall T shape. Three across the top, three tall, and it can either be a forest or a blue water. So remember, this does have to have at least one square on a ruined space. Of course, those ruins are one squares themselves, but hopefully you can fit it into the plan you had for filling in all your spaces. And remember, we will be scoring the A Greenbow one more time at the end of for the last season, so if you want to go green on this, you can potentially score some more points at the end of the game during the last season with that play, which is, I believe, what I want to do with it. Best plan, maybe not, but it's an attempt at making sure I score something with this shape. So I'm going to go right here around the edge of this mountain. It touches this ruin that's next to the mountain. Fills in this little corner, and will help me filling in this column as well, eventually. So that Outpost Ruin card does stay with the deck, gets shuffled back in, so we leave it in that row. It just does not have a number towards the season. Currently sitting at a total of 4 for the season. Our next card is going to be the Treetop Village. We've seen this before. It is the elongated Z shape. That is either a green forest or a red village. Ooh, tricky, tricky, and I think all three, three. This is where it gets a little tricky. I'm making decisions. Because I like using the green force because I know I can score it multiple times. If I do it right, I could score multiple rows and columns. At the end, if I go red, I could only basically score once for 3 points. So this becomes on, does it play better into the C scoring for erosion columns? Which in this case, it might for me. Yeah, I'm gonna go bold with this move since I didn't earlier. Down here at the bottom, next to my mountain, next to that other forest, I'm gonna use the village option, and that completes at least one row for me. Okay, so we're currently at a total of 6 for the season. We're looking for 8 or more. So it is potential that the next card, if it's at least a 2, could be our last card for the round. So keep that in mind as you're placing your current shape, and we'll get ready to for the next one. If I need to slow down at all, just let me know. So our next card is going to be the Great River. We've seen this before. It is a 1x3 plus a coin, or the big W shape. Both of them would have to be the blue water option. This is a 1 in the corner, so it will not complete our season. So keep in mind, you will get at least one more card. Okay, so we know I'm playing heavily into the complete rows and columns. So do I continue that, or... did I make it too difficult to myself to complete that? I think... well, I know it has to be blue, of course. Well, I can go up here, trap myself in using a 1x1. That other card may or may not come out, so I could hurt myself by not being able to complete that column, but it would surround a mountain, guaranteeing a coin. I could pull it down here, guaranteeing a coin, not block that off. Potential over here. I think that's what I'm liking right now. Yep, I'm going to go over here. And something I like to do sometimes is go ahead and start covering some of those ruined spaces. It gives you a little bit more flexibility near the last rounds. If those ruin cards come out and you're forced to play onto them and they're already gone, then you can start placing those 1x1s wherever you want to. I'm going to choose the W shape instead of the 1x3 of the coin, because I'm going to instead earn a coin for surrounding this mountain. Okay. And since, like I said, we're at a total of 7 for the season, we'll keep going with another card until we get to 8 or more. Okay, so this is the one card that I would have needed if I'd gone up top. I was afraid it wouldn't show up. But it did. So I may have hurt myself by not being super bold. It is what it is. I can still have fun with this. This is the Riftlands. It is a 1x1 square anywhere on the board of any terrain type you like, just not a mountain. So you can make it a forest, you can make it a village, a farm, a water. Or if you really wanted to, you can make it a monster. But just keep in mind, there's really no advantage to making it a monster right now. And that does add 0 to the season, so we'll be drawing one more card after this. But I can use it to my advantage and get at least one more terrain type over here next to my red village. I'm going to make it, gonna make it some water. Yeah, I'll make it a water space. Just for the fun of it. I'll put that right there. Next to the mountain. Hopefully I can surround the mountain. If not, it at least helps me score my village right there. Okay. So again, now this is highly likely to be the last card. Yeah, so is there ever a reason to add a Riftlands monster? Not that I can think of in the base Cartographers game. Not unless you just somehow need a different type of terrain type next to a village. But typically, you can use one of the other terrains. So, I believe in the heroes... I don't know if... I can't remember if you can actually get points for killing monsters. But there are heroes that basically block monster spaces and, like, kill parts of the monster. Keep it from spreading. But I'm not sure I've ever seen a direct reason to draw a monster when you have the Rift Lance. I think it's more a clarification that a monster is considered a terrain type. Because then on some of these cards you're already showing it, so you might as well show it there just so it eliminates any confusion during the rest of gameplay. But you are correct. I don't think there's a reason. Okay, so potentially the last card, unless we got another Ruins type card popping up. Hey, I called it. We have our Ruins again. That was the only card that could extend it to one additional card draw, but we're still drawing one last shape. So the shape we have to put on a Ruins, this time it's the Temple Ruins, but all the Ruins are the same on your map, just different names on the cards, is going to be the Homestead. This is kind of the classic Tetris short T shape, three across, but only two tall on the T. It can either be a red village or a yellow farmland, which we have not had many of. Okay, so I have two choices. Really only one choice that benefits me, because remember, this does have to go on a ruined space. I left this space open over here, so I can fit it into this corner, cover this ruins, surround my mountain, and at the same time complete a row. So let's make sure I don't forget to fill in the coin for the mountain. And because of the total of the two on that, we have a total of 2, 4, 6, 7, 9 for the season. We are done drawing cards for the season. We'll move on to scoring. I'll go ahead and score mine. Go through the scoring kind of like we did last time. If you have any questions, feel free to ask. We'll start with the green gold plains again. Scoring 3 points for each of your red village sections that are touching three different terrain types. So in this case, I still have my first one that I scored before, because it's touching a mountain, water, and forest. So that's one. Next up down here at the bottom, I have one touching a monster, a mountain, and a farmland. That's another one, because remember, monsters count as a terrain type. Then over here, I have one touching forest, water, mountain, and farms. So it's as long as it's at least three. So I have three different ones scoring three for each, so that's 9 points. Now for C, scoring option, we're going to score 6 points for each complete row and column that you've completely filled in with terrain. So for my columns, I have one complete column, now I have two complete rows. So it's 3 times 6, 18 points. Now for my coins, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 coins currently. And again, I have no negative points from monsters because I've completely surrounded my monster for all adjacent spaces. And we did not have another monster come out to generate more negative points. Now, but that monster does remain in the deck, and we'll be adding another one, so it gets a little bit more dangerous as we move on to the future rounds and seasons. So I got 0 on that. So my total score for that season is going to be 9 plus 18, that's 27 plus 6 is 33 points. Now, if Duchess, you're still playing along, or if anyone else is playing, let me know how you did. If you felt that round went better, worse for you, either way. It's kind of fun to see how well everyone is doing as we play along. And I'll prepare for our next round. Again, we're going to add another monster into the deck, shuffle it up. What's going on? Where do I get Discord notification for? Way down. There's something I haven't read in a long time. I can ignore it for now. Making sure no one was needed anything on Discord, since I am a mod in a couple of different Discord channels. Keep that up in the corner, but this time it's not critical. And if y'all have any ideas or suggestions on what y'all feel I should do with the channel points for things y'all can redeem for, feel free to pop those in the chat. I set up a few things, but I'm happy to update them, change them, or even add something new. It's what helps with interaction, and you have found valuable on either your own channels or when you're in other people's channels, the things you enjoy using the points for. I've talked about, I do have a parrot onesie over here above my shoulder hanging on the wall that it'll be a little bit higher point value, but once it's turned in, I'll wear it for the whole stream once it's turned in. Of course, everyone has some kind of hydrate type thing. I changed the name of mine because it's probably not typically going to be water. So you can debate how much it actually hydrates me. Sometimes it'll be juice, energy drink, soda, whatever my choice of the day is. Okay, so next up we have fall. So during the fall, we'll end up scoring the C and the D scoring cards. Again, the Borderlands for complete rows and columns. And then D is the Canal Lake. And this is earn one reputation star for each water space adjacent to at least one farm space. And of course, you can also earn one reputation star for each farm space next to at least one water space. So they're kind of scoring for each other, so it really benefits to set them next to each other. So you can see I've done a little bit of that so far, but I probably want to try to gain a lot more of those. And just as a reminder, we will be scoring the green bow again during the next season, so keep in mind the green force that popped up. This time we're only looking for a total of 7, not 8 as the previous ones, so the later seasons do get a little bit shorter. And our first card is going to be the Ruins card. So, like we've talked about before, this next card drawn will have to go on one of your Ruins spaces. If you no longer have ruins available, you can draw a 1x1 square of any terrain type anywhere on your board or map. So, the card. Thank you very much. I appreciate the bits. It means a lot. Thank you for stopping by, hanging out as long as you could. I hope you have a wonderful day, evening, whatever time it is for you, and that you can spread some joy and play some more games throughout the week. Okay, where was it? Oh, so the Treetop Village, Green Forest or Red Village, elongated Z, and it will have to go onto one of your ruin spaces. Okay, so since we know the Red Villages are not scoring anymore, I would highly recommend, which this is what I'll be doing. I'll be doing making it a forest, because no matter what, you might be able to score at least a couple points. So I only have a couple of ruined spaces left. They're both up here. So I don't block myself off and create little pockets that I can't fill in. I'm going to choose this one that's already around this corner. Kind of pop it in around here. Make that Z happen right there. Elongated Z. Where the bottom is 3 long instead of a 2 long. Hopefully I can complete above it too to complete another column. Our next card is going to be the Forgotten Forest. We've seen this before, but I'll explain it again. Either 2 1x1 squares that are perfectly diagonal to each other also earns you 1 coin, or you can do a standard Z shape. Regardless of which you pick, this will have to be a green forest. So I know part of our goal is to fill in rows and columns. So I think I want to... I don't want to block off my water space yet, because I want to find a village or a farm that touches the water. So I probably don't want to play it there. But what I can hope to do is... leaving my options open. I don't have a green across this row. I don't have green up and down here. So of the options, I think I'm going to go right here, go and go with the Z shape. puts me a lot closer to completing a couple of rows, and as points for both columns and a row for green force for later scoring. Okay, our next card coming up is going to be a monster. So this is our Bugbear Assault, starting in the upper right corner. This is going to be technically two different sections, or two different parts. They're both going to be one wide, two tall, with a one wide, two tall separating between them. This has to start in the upper right, and it will continue going clockwise around the board until it fully fits in. Remember, you stick against the far side of the board, going around clockwise if it doesn't fit, and then you shift in one square going around again. So let's show how that would fit onto my map. So starting in the upper right, because of this mountain space, it can't fit in this top part, so we shift down one, can't go, but we shift down one more, and it does fit right here. Now, it has no value to add to the season, but you do have to keep in mind any adjacent space next to these purple spaces that are empty at the end of a round will be negative points. So just to show how that works, we currently have 7 empty spaces, which would be negative 7 points at the end of this round, or end of the season and the next season. So that's potentially up to negative 14 points on the game. So it is really helpful to start surrounding that. Now this is the only round or only time that bugbear will come out, so we do not have to add it back to the deck later. But remember, there's at least one more monster in this deck currently. But we keep going for the season, currently at 3, looking for a total of 7, and we find our fishing village, a 1x4 that is either village or water. So what I'm going to do here, because I know I want to block some of this monster spaces, I can also complete a column with it. I'm going to fill in this right next to this monster, filling in right here with the water. Because like we've talked about, the villages don't really score you anything else, so you might as well go with the water, so you have a higher potential to find your farms next to it. Got a text that I have a package to pick up, which I can do that later. I believe that is a birthday gift from someone in my family that they said should be arriving today, so I look forward to seeing what they decided to send me. It's always nice to get a little surprise gift from family and friends when you have a birthday, mine was last week, so I guess a birthday present to myself I get to celebrate is getting affiliate as part of my birthday week, because I started getting to set it up last week. Our next card, we're a total of 5 currently, looking for 7 on the season. We found our Riftlands again. This is a 1x1 of any terrain type except mountains. So, forest, village, farm, water, or monster if you so choose. That would go anywhere on your board, added 0 to the season. So this is where I can either start blocking off another monster space, or I can really play into gaining points for the canal lake of farms next to water. So I have a couple of options here. I could play up here into covering our last ruins to really guarantee I can place it anywhere. But most likely most shapes don't fit into that. There's only one shape that would, and I'm okay with the color that would force into that. Since I've played this enough, I know a lot of the shapes. So I'm not going to actually fill in out there. I could start blocking monsters, but say I block one space, that's really what saving 2 points total for the game. So what I'm going to do, I'm actually going to play down here next to this water, picking my farm. That's two waters that did not have farms next to it, plus this one can score, and I've completed a row. So there's multiple benefits for looking around, seeing how many points you can score, and if you can capitalize on multiple scoring cards at the same time. So our next card is going to be the orchard. This is either green forest or a yellow farms with the L shape. Not the elongated L, just the kind of standard short L, three tall, two wide at the bottom. Now keep in mind, this will complete our season, so after we place this, we will be scoring. So hopefully you can make the most out of this, scoring a lot of points. So this is a shape that works out well for me, and that I can put it up here next to the water that I had set up, completing both a column and scoring multiple water form adjacencies. So we'll go through score this now. So we've scored the sea before, but I'll go over it again. You will get 6 points for every complete row and complete column. So let's count up how many I have. I have 1, 2, 3 columns and 1, 2, 3 rows. So 6 total times 6 is going to be 36 points. That's why I love seeing that scoring option near the end of the game, because you can really build into it and score a lot of points if you do it right. Now next up we have the canal lake. Remember, you get 1 point for every farm touching a water and every water touching a farm. So I'm going to start at the top of my map and we'll move down. Right here are farms and waters adjacent to each other. So this is, for each of these farms, that's 1, 2, 3, because they're each touching water. And each of these waters, so that's 6 total right here. And then this farm is touching water, so that's 7. 8 for this touching the farm. 9 for that touching the farm. 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So 15 total. And then coins, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Still, I have not changed how many I have. Then for monster spaces, which would be negative points, I currently have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's going to be negative 5 points, because that's 5 adjacent spaces next to a monster that are still empty. So currently my score for that round, 36 plus 15 plus 6 minus 5. So the 36 plus 15, 51 plus 6, 57 minus 5 is 52 points on the round. Probably one of my, probably not best, but one of my top rounds I've had, especially for the third season. Typically my best ends up being in the winter season, which is the last one. But part of that depends on how all of the scoring options are mixed in. Okay, so we're going to mix all those up. If you're playing along, let me know how you're doing. If you were able to get a lot of those rows and columns or canals points, let me know how you did. Mixing in this last monster card. And we will be moving to winter, which will score the D and A options. Kind of shift those, have those a little bit higher. So we've talked about this before, the canal lake, which we've just scored. Farms and waters touching each other. Each can score 1 point for each touching the other. And the green bow, 1 point per column and 1 point per row that has at least one forest in it. And we're building up our forest. So that's when you can get a decent amount of points, and not quite as many as the Borderlands, but it does have a high potential, because if you complete all the rows and all the columns, there's, 11 rows, 11 columns, I believe, so that's, you can get over 20 points. Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, so yeah, you can get 22 points if you're able to fill them all in. If you're able to do that twice somehow, that's over 40 points just on that one card for the game. Okay, let's get ready. So, in the winter, we're looking for a total of 6, so the number of cards we're looking to draw is a lot less than the previous rounds, so be prepared for that. Plan ahead if you're able. We have our Great River again. It's our 1x3 with the coin, or the W shape of water. So let's see where you can get those points, where you can squeeze something in. of course it has to be water. I'm gonna squeeze in. So I don't have to worry about the Borderlands again, because we've already scored that twice. So you don't have to worry about completing rows and columns anymore. So now you want to really maximize your canals and greens and not having as many negative points for monsters. So with that in mind, I'm thinking minimizing monster points is most critical. So I'm going to put this right up here, blocking at least two monster spaces in the edge of the mountain. And there's a little bit of hope to hold out that we can finish surrounding that mountain as well. I do get the coin for choosing the smaller shape. And we'll move on to the next card. The next card will be the Hamlet. We've seen this once before near the beginning. But of course we can do it again. It's the small V with the coin, or the larger square with the one sticking off of it on the side. Both of these would have to be villages though. Especially at this point in the game, since villages don't score, maximizing other things surrounding mountains, getting the little coins off these is also helpful to do. Or like we've talked about, blocking off monster spaces. I'm gonna block off some monster space down here. Go and take the simple coin. Now my other option was up here surrounding this mountain for an extra coin, but also blocked off potential for more water next to this, so it's kind of that 50-50 chance I'm taking. Well, not really 50-50 chance, I don't know the exact. But it's just taking a chance. I get about the same number of points, because I'm blocked a monster versus getting a mountain, but I have higher potential points remaining on that other side. Next card is going to be a marshland. This is our large T-shaped green forest or blue waters. Three across the top, three tall. Now keep in mind, you can either try to score for the greens, or if you have spaces for the blue next to some farms, you can do that as well. So I think my highest value option, kind of like I save this space, I can fit this T into this junction surrounding this mountain and making sure I score more for that canal. So I do get to fill in another coin for that mountain. Currently we're sitting at four total, looking for six or more on the winter season. So this next card has potential to be the last card drawn for the season. So let's see what it is. It is the Homestead. And like I said, because we're looking for six or more, this is a two. We're hitting six. So this is the last card of the season and of the game. So place it accordingly. This is either a red village or a yellow farm. And the short T shape of a three across the top, two down the middle. So in this case, if you set up kind of like I have, you have the potential to put the farmland next to some water. So I'm going to do this, since it's three wide and two tall, I'm going to fit it in across this. I know I don't need to complete that column, but what it does, it scores a little bit extra than if I'd stuffed it right against the other blue into a corner, because I can score double here and double here for 4 points, as opposed to around the corner of one for just 3 points. So we'll go into the last season of scoring at this point, and we'll add it all up. So first off, we'll score the canal lake, like we talked about before. 1 point for each farm touching water, and one for each water touching farms. And hello, Tailwagon Games. Thank you for joining us today. I hope you're doing well and that you had a wonderful Monday and wonderful weekend. let me know what you've been up to, what you've been playing. It was great getting to play Blood on the Clock Tower with you Saturday night on the Game Coverage stream. It was kind of really funny to see how, as a couple, that y'all kind of bantered and just messed with each other through the whole game. And that may have actually paid off for the evil team. So we're in the middle of scoring the winter season of Cartographers at the moment. So I was going over how to score the canal lake of 1 point for a farm touching water and 1 point for the water touching farms. And let me count my up of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 21. And then we're going to score our green bar again, which has, you get 1 point for each column and each row that has at least one green forest in it. So let's add that up. I'm going to go columns first. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 for the columns. We'll go rows next. And just add it on top of the 9. For 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18 total. Coins. I currently have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 coins. And negative points for monsters for anything not covered adjacently to monsters. 1, 2, negative 2. And let's see. Duchess said 43 that round. Total of 108. Ooh, let's see what mine totaled to. So for that round, I took 21 plus 18 is 39 plus 9 is 48 minus 2 is 46 on the round. So really close on this on the round. Tell the wagon to send Blood on the Clock Tower. It was so much fun. We had a blast playing that. We've been having fun playing Lost Ruins of Arnak on BGA lately. Nice. I still have yet to play that on BGA. I've only played the physical copy. I know a while back I played Lost Ruins here on my stream. Yes, it is my first affiliate stream. Thank you. So I hit it just about a week ago, but because, as you know, setting up some of the stuff and like channel points, emotes, and stuff like that, it took until today to be able to do my first affiliate stream. So I decided to do a little bit longer stream so people have more chance to earn the channel points, which for this I'm calling them slices of joy. Because part of what we do here, we're trying to spread some joy as we play games. So, the more you hang out, hopefully the more joy you have acquired. So, now I need to get my total score for the whole game. 15 plus 33 is 48 for the first two rounds. Ooh, thank you very much. Thank you for the subscription. It means a lot. I might have to turn down that sound that startled me for a second. So 48 plus the 52 from the third round puts me at 100 plus 46 from last, so 146 for the total game. Now, if you were actually playing full solo rules, you would subtract the numbers found on the bottom corners of these four cards to see what your actual solo score was. We're acting like it's a true multiplayer game. We're not having to subtract those. So you can really revel in your high scores. Because it's more fun that way. So yeah, that was Cartographers. That was the B side of the map. What we'll probably do, we'll play some other games. And we might come back to playing that again later. Because I'll be streaming until 11 o'clock p.m. Eastern tonight. So, and it is currently, what, 7? So I am, yeah, I got 4 more hours to hang out with y'all, have a lot of fun, play some games. We've already played Fiber Finding, just finished Cartographers. I have number 9, which is really fast to play. I don't know if y'all have tried that before. I'll play Sagrada. Then if y'all have a suggestion from the solo optional games off my shelf, I might pull something off or rotate and play these same games again. So I'll start cleaning this up. And y'all can decide if y'all want to play number 9 or Sagrada next. Those off to the side. And for those who have not been here the whole time, I have been playing on the Cartographers Heroes playmat. that I was fortunate enough that ThunderWorks Games sent me when they knew I was streaming this game a while back. And then, as luck would have it, it didn't arrive on time for the first time I was streaming Cartographers. So I've been more than happy to continually use it, A, to support them because they're supporting me, and because it is a beautiful map and a wonderful game. Need to head out. Well, thank you for stopping by, Duchess. I really appreciate it. And hopefully I can have the chance to stop by your stream when I'm available, because yours is always amazing to be part of. And thank you for the bits as well. Wait up at the top. There we go. Yes, so this mat is one of those nice neoprene style mats. Rolls up nicely. Fits right on the shelf behind all the small box games, so it doesn't even get in my way.